So greetings, hello. This is Thomas Daffern speaking. Today is Sunday, the 4th of August, 2019. I'm giving my weekly address about the problems facing Britain, arguing in favour of Remain and discussing how we can organise that. I'm speaking as a philosopher and intellectual and historian of ideas, and you know, we're at a sort of critical turning point at the moment. So let me give the bigger picture. So I've just got back from a brief visit to the Pyrenees, where I was organising a conference on actually to do with the esoteric history of the Pyrenees region in France, which is an extraordinary part of the world. In Spain, it's the borderland between southwest France and Spain. It's had many civilizations living there for centuries, millennia actually, starting, well, going right back to Paleolithic man, you know, 200,000 years ago, cave dwellers were living there, and eventually they developed into quite an advanced artistic culture, Magdalenian culture it's called, doing cave paintings. One of the most famous of these caves is Lascaux, which is a bit further up in the Dordogne region. But it's the same culture as from the Pyrenees. They were goddess worshippers, they were shamans, they were proto-druids, if you want. And that's our ancestry as Europeans, actually. So it's a very sacred landscape, this Pyrenees region. Later, we know that out of those people, different kinds of later civilizations evolved. The Celtic peoples evolved, and we know that also there were some extraordinary toing and froing of civilizations. So the Celts left a big impress on the Pyrenees region. The Greeks were there, and the Carthaginians from Phoenicia, who'd settled in Carthage, also founded trading ports along the coast of Spain. The legend of Pyrenees is very beautiful and rather mournful, but it's named after a lover of Hercules, the great Greek and Roman god, who had these 12 labours to do. Now, Hercules, during the course of his labours, was sent all over the Mediterranean. He passed through that region, and he fell in love with a beautiful, the daughter of a local chieftain called Pyrene. And they had a, you know, passionate summer romance, great love on both sides. But then he had to leave her and go on with his labours, travel on, like Aeneas did. You know, it's the epic. But unfortunately, Pyrene was deeply broken-hearted. It turned out she was pregnant. She couldn't tell her father. It would shame him. She didn't know what to do, so she went out into the forest and was attacked and killed by a boar, I think. Anyway, she screamed as she died, and Hercules, who set off on his journey, heard her screams and hurried back, but was too late to save her. And in his grief, he buried her, and then he gathered up all the rocks, the huge boulders from the plain of Toulouse, north of the Pyrenees, and he piled them on top of her tomb as a permanent memorial. And that became the Pyrenees Mountains. So it's a sad but beautiful story. The mountains represent the grief of Hercules at being unable to save his lover, his beloved, and coming back too late. It's the kind of nightmare scenario that we all dread, you know, finding your beloved dead. I'll come back to that metaphor a bit later, because it seems to me that with Brexit, we're hearing the screams just in time to hurry back and save Britain, because, you know, this is a catastrophe for Britain. I cannot impress upon my readers and listeners how much, and I don't know if you have to be a druid to see this, or some kind of, you know, mystic or seer, but surely people can realise that this is a catastrophe for the UK. I mean, unless you're really hell-bent on self-destruction and you know, can't see the consequences, all the evidence is there. Of course, if you choose to live without looking at that, and just to go on with a kind of blind, fatal adherence to the Brexit cult, of whose, you know, the main mantra is, we're leaving, now it's Boris who's articulating this, we're leaving on October the 31st, that's it, nothing's going to stop us. Dominic Cummings is now saying, well, there's nothing anyone can do, we're leaving, that's it. Boris has shut Parliament down. I mean, in my opinion, this is such an emergency. Parliament should have sat all summer to debate this. It's scandalous. But of course, the people that are running the Tory party have captured it. Don't want discussion, don't want democratic debate, don't want people like me speaking out. You know, they want ignorance and blind obedience to what the elite have said, which is, by their misinterpretation and manipulation of the 2016 referendum result, they're now, they've captured the British state and are going to orchestrate and engineer its breakup. So anyway, it was a very interesting conference down in the Pyrenees. We discussed Brexit, but not only. I mean, many speeches took place. People who lived there, some were British origin. And one of my complaints against Brexit is it fails to honour the many, many Brits who've come to live in Europe and who are still British and still vote in Britain, still love Britain, and don't want to go back to this petty nationalism and watch the UK break up into its constituent pieces. One of the themes that came up down there was, because it was a conference about esoteric history in the Pyrenees, it's a place where Mary Magdalene has been associated, possibly having come from escaping from Judea when, you know, the crisis happened. There are many traditions that Mary Magdalene came to the south of France. She's always struck me as one of the most interesting of the disciples, the most Gnostic, the most important female disciple, and the first to witness the resurrection. She's called the Apostle of the Apostles. So some speeches were addressing that question, and we had some good discussions about it. One of the things to come out is, why has esotericism been associated with right-wing thinkers? There's a whole sort of right-wing esotericism. And we know that, you know, Nazis used to send people looking for the Holy Grail down in the Pyrenees and so on. But in my talk, I reminded people there's also a left-wing esotericism, which balances that, which is not about using esoteric or occult knowledge for your own advantage, your own race, your own nation. That was right-wing occultism, which is like our nation first, our race first. That was Rosenberg and his myth of the 20th century, that was Nazi ideology and fascist. Against that is internationalism and cosmopolitanism and left-wing esotericism. And I spoke about that. The Pyrenees were the haven of escape for people from Nazi-occupied France. There are these Chemin de Liberté and Walter Benjamin and many thousands of Jewish intellectuals and other left-wing intellectuals fled, some successfully, some not. In the village where we were, Allée-les-Bains, you know, there was an American person who parachuted in to help the French resistance who died. They still remember him to this day. Every year they commemorate his death, as they do here in my village in France, in Bertet. So that left-wing esotericism, represented really by Roosevelt, who was a Freemason, and Churchill, who was on the liberal wing of the Conservative Party. He was an intellectual internationalist, and he was a Freemason as well, and a Druid, in fact, Churchill. And, you know, these people realised that the only way to build a peaceful world with things like the United Nations at the end of the war was to bring people together. Nations have to find what they have in common, which is where the idea of the United Nations came from. And my country, Canada, also was instrumental in all that. And that's why the Council of Europe was brought into being, which Churchill supported. It was his idea. Roosevelt worked with Jean Monnet, who wanted even more than the Council of Europe. And he wanted a kind of an interlocking of the economies of Germany and France, particularly the two most important European economies, and eventually Britain and Italy, so that we would never go to war against each other. Today in history marks, tragically, the day on which the German army, in 1914, the German cavalry crossed into Belgium for the first attack of the First World War. You know, this is the day, 4th of August, on which we lament, you know, this absurdity, when these nations all went to war. Well, what Churchill, Roosevelt and the left-wing esotericists created was an institution which makes war much less likely and all but impossible. So I'm speaking as a peace scholar, peace researcher. My talk in the Pyrenees was about that. It's witnessed many wars, but on the whole, it's witnessed peace. And the people of the Pyrenees are very profound. It was the first place in Europe where witchcraft was first targeted by the Inquisition, and witches were being, you know, hauled up and persecuted by courts. It's also where the Inquisition was discovered and invented by St. Dominic and his Dominicans, initially to oppose the Cathars. And there were speeches about the Cathar tradition and why the Dominicans and the Catholics hated them so much. I spoke about the kind of free-form Christianity that the Gnostic traditions of Christianity believed in. It seems to me we have a human right to wisdom. We are Homo sapiens. And as Kant said, we have to learn to dare to be wise. That heritage of which the Cathars are part, and Catholics are also part, it belongs to us as Europeans. We don't have to take sides retrospectively, except for truth, for justice, and for peace. You know, there were good people on all sides, and there were war crimes committed on all sides. But I have to say, by far the worst war crimes were in suppressing the Cathars. It's interesting also, at the same time, the same forces that were suppressing the Cathars were also suppressing the Jews. And one of the reasons the Catholics came down so heavily on the Cathars was because they were fundamentally anti-Semitic. They were also attacking the Jews. And there'd been a discussion a century or so before featuring a very famous rabbi, Nachmanides, who had... he was from Girona, which is just across the Pyrenees into Spain, in Catalonia. And Girona was a centre for Kabbalistic studies. It was a haven of intellectual liberty. And there'd been in that region a Jewish kingdom called Septimania, which included Narbonne and that part, all the way probably to Girona. And that had flourished with a lot of deep esoteric learning and Kabbalah and so on. So the Cathars are obviously influenced. There was a permeable exchange of ideas going on. In the Kabbalah, they believe in reincarnation. Isaac Luria and the other great Kabbalists of Safat believe that, you know, our life is a continual process of what's called Gilgul, which is the reincarnation process. And what we learn in one life, we take with us and we try and get it better next time. And it's a continual spiral journey till we reach the throne room of the Heavenly King, like Enoch. And you know, after enlightenment, we can choose to come back and help, teach, and so on, like a bodhisattva. But it's not sort of karmically necessary. I personally swore a bodhisattva vow that I would keep teaching and healing and you know, meditating till the whole planet reaches enlightenment. So I'm afraid I'm here for the long haul. I'm just trying to speed it up. but these poor old Cathars were really persecuted, as were the Jews. And Nachmanides actually won the debate against the Dominicans who attempted to silence him. In front of the King of Spain, they were discussing the nature of the Messiah, whether he'd come yet or not. What kind of a Messiah was going to be. And Nachmanides pointed out that if it was Jesus, well, what kind of Messiah was that? Because the world had been in one continual, endless war zone ever since. If the Messiah's mission is supposed to bring world peace, which it was and is, then how come Jesus hadn't done that? Because there have been continual battles and wars ever since, and the Christian armies have been one of the most brutal and bloodthirsty of them all. It's a very good point Nachmanides made. The Dominicans didn't have a response. They couldn't explain, you know. And ultimately, they just wanted to shut him up. And although he won the debate, the King of Spain gave him, you know, essentially the victory. But then the Dominicans pulled strings and got him expelled from the kingdom anyway. Well, what did Nabonides do? He went to Jerusalem on pilgrimage and found it very barren, very few Jews there. It was the time of the Crusader kingdom. And when these crusaders had captured Jerusalem, they slaughtered every single Muslim and every single Jew in the city who'd been living there amicably. It's one of the blackest stains, in my opinion, on Christendom, the way they captured Jerusalem and destroyed the people there. And Nachmanides refounded a synagogue. Which is still going to this day in Jerusalem. If you go to the old city and ask for the synagogue of Nachmanides, it's still there. And what you find in the synagogues is a library. Synagogues are places of study as well as prayer, which is what all churches should be. So you'll find, you know, a whole library of books in these synagogues, and fantastic, so there should be. So the silencing of Nachmanides didn't work, because wisdom always pops up in new places. Well, then the Christians thought, well, I know what we'll do. We'll burn all their books, and we'll institute book burning of the Talmud, which was the great compendium of the sages, the commentaries on the commentaries of the Mishnah, and detailed discussions of the meaning of the Torah, the text. And, you know, Rashi, the great commentator from Champagne region, Troyes, in France here, had done a commentary. That was often in these books. These books were handwritten, these great Talmud volumes. And in the spring of 1242, Louis, the King of France, who was later made a saint, I don't regard him as an authentic saint at all, he ordered that the Talmuds of France should be rounded up, and a commission was convened, and the Jews of France from all the cities had to surrender their Talmuds. In the spring of 1242, they were heaped together in Vincennes, 24 cartloads of them, more than 20,000 volumes. And each one was the handwritten creation of a scribe who'd spent many hours, often many months, carefully hand-copying its words onto clean sheets of paper. And then, in the spring of 1242, a flame was lit, the pages burned, and the words ascended back to heaven. This was a book burning of 20,000 volumes, overseen by the Dominicans and sanctioned by this so-called saintly king, King Louis, who was in the middle of his final persecution of the Cathars, because that happened in the spring of 1242. In 1244, 2 years later, the last really serious stronghold of the Cathars at Montségur was sacked. And this time they burned people. They didn't just burn the books. There's a legend that a few Cathar books and a couple of people escaped the night before. But, you know, you can see the kind of ideology of these extremists. So you burn the books, you burn the people. Why? Because they had a watertight kind of ideology that brooked no discussion, no subtlety of intellect, no thought. And this is my concern about Brexit. It's a watertight, you know, sort of ideology. It's like a cult that wants to shut down all intellectual discussion. And is a kind of, the army that destroyed Montségur was essentially a mob whipped up by extremists who were anti-Semites and anti-intellectual. Sound familiar? okay, so I want to explain, this by the way is taken from a very important book, Stolen Words, by Mark Glickman, the Nazi plunder of Jewish books. And there's a picture, when the Nazis implemented their Holocaust against the Jews, which was really a continuation of the ideology of the anti-Cathar attacks and the anti-Semitic attacks of the Middle Ages. If you read the history of anti-Semitism, it was an accumulative effect. It was the hatred of Jewish intellectuals, the hatred of the Talmud, the hatred of their scholarship, and so on and so on, because people felt threatened by it. And if you identified yourself as a Christian, you know, whatever that means, you had to then not be in support or sympathy with the other. My form of Christianity, which is a Druid Christianity, is very different. We love the other. We're holistic, integral, transpersonal thinkers, as the Druids have always been. But unfortunately, these kind of antipathetic thinkers, they feed off creating another who is going to be something that then excuses rivalry and ultimately violence. This is warrior thinking. The people behind the Nazis weren't warriors, you know, Corporal Hitler, etc. And the people behind crusading Christianity that destroyed the Cathars were also warriors. Simon de Montfort's father, the one that founded Parliament, a warrior, his father was the greatest slaughterer of Cathars. Horrendous lack of human rights. No war crime was too bad for them to do. So this conference was very interesting. It leads me now to make the following observations, which is, what's the pattern behind all these tragic events? What's the pattern behind the slaughter of the Cathars? What's the pattern behind the Holocaust, the slaughter of the Jews and their books? What's the pattern behind Brexit, with the silencing of opposition and the cultish type self-destruction that it's doing? Well, I came to the conclusion some years ago as a philosopher. I'd spent many, many years studying wisdom, reading all the classic wisdom texts, studying every single great thinker I could find in the libraries of West and East, North and South. I've travelled to 33 countries, meeting saints and sages from every faith tradition etc. Studying wisdom, did a PhD on the finer points of comparing wisdom traditions and so on. Only to discover, looking up from my books, that the world seems to be getting more and more stupid, and that the continual wars that are being pursued and going on, like were going on in these ancient times. You know, I can hear the screams of these people in my mind, just as Hercules could hear the screams of Pyrenees. So I thought that as a philosopher and intellectual, what we should be doing is actually spending some time looking at the counterforce. What is ignorance? If we love wisdom, it follows by definition we must hate ignorance, or at least oppose it or try and educate it. And as a teacher, I know that that's a daily struggle for teachers in schools in Britain and around the world. There is obviously an inbuilt kind of default to ignorance in particularly younger or sort of teenage children, it seems to be, where people become quite rude, hostile and aggressive to the very concept of wisdom. Very dismissive of spirituality, the notion of God, you know, all the usual stuff. One goes through that adolescent phase of hating oneself, others, God if he exists, you know, that kind of thing. And it seems to me that, therefore, we need to study ignorance in order to be able to counter its moves. And so that led me a few years ago now to write a book, a chapter in the book, which I co-wrote with a scientific friend of mine, Dr. Eva Zorovnik. And I did a chapter which I think is one of the most important writings I've done recently, called Towards a Critical Epistemology of Ignorance. And I think I'm going to publish it as a separate book because it's important. I looked at the literature around the study of ignorance, and there is a literature. It comes mainly from sociology. There's a whole field of sociology of ignorance, which rightly says that certain elites benefit from keeping other groups ignorant, keeping, you know, the masses ignorant. There's a book by Avital Ronell called Stupidity, which came out in 2002, which talks about stupidity, which is a sort of extreme form of ignorance. It's related, not quite the same. And there's a tradition of thought among Marxist thinkers that she highlights, Gramsci, Ernest Bloch, even Lenin, Lukács, the Hungarian thinker, and others, have tried to discuss social stupidity. Is it that capitalism actually requires social stupidity in order to be able to go on extracting profits from the surplus labour of workers who are basically being scammed all the time by capital? That's the Marxist argument, and I think there's some truth in this. What Avital Ronell says is, nobody understood alienated labour better than Marx. He put it on the table as being, among other well-known effects, responsible for the production of stupidity. The state is a pusher of stupidity, dealing it in strong doses to the worker. In the main, stupidity is an opiate, a weapon wielded against the working class, zapping and incapacitating it. That's from Avital Ronell's book, Stupidity, page 56. So this is important stuff, right? And my argument on this talk today is that Brexit is another example of this pushing of stupidity onto the masses, the working classes. And it's been done with unbelievable subtlety and intelligence by a manipulative elite of Anglo-American elite capitalists who have decided, they themselves showing their own stupidity, that it will be to the advantage of capital itself. I don't think it will, because I think the City of London is going to crash and the instruments of global capitalism will collapse. And as Scotland leaves the UK, and the European Union re-welcomes Scotland, I don't think Little England is going to survive in its current form. In its the wealth that these Brexiteers trumpeted, sixth wealthiest nation on earth. No, that's Scotland, Wales, England, Ireland as part of the EU. That's not post-Brexit England going it alone. So, and yet people are still doing it, still arguing for Brexit. There's now a hard right, xenophobic extremist faction who've basically taken over Parliament through a sleight of hand where a tiny minority of people from the country as a whole, i.e. the Conservative Party, have voted Boris Johnson into being the Prime Minister with no mandate from Parliament or from the British people. So how are we letting this happen? What are the forces underlying it? Well, I'm arguing in this talk that this is ignorance. And I'm going to try and identify what types of ignorance. In my initial essay on this subject, I went into 25 types of ignorance, which I, as a historian, have witnessed in my studies of history. Like Toynbee, I've looked at how civilizations historically rise and fall. And I've also looked at how religions and philosophy traditions rise and fall. And, I've tried to chart that pattern. I would say, in a nutshell, how they fall is when the sum total of ignorance becomes a kind of tsunami. Each culture is a balance between ignorance and wisdom. As long as the wise and the wisdom element is to the fore and pushing forward, that civilization will thrive and flourish. And one of the things about wise civilizations is they're open. They don't have, paranoid borders. They remain open to exchange, to trade, to exploration, to welcoming the guest, to hospitality rules and so on. When civilizations implode and become fearful and persecute the other, as the Nazis did, to take an extreme example, their time is up. Because if you think of all life as one great kind of life force, and all global civilizations are part of that onrushing stream of Homo sapiensness, that itself is like an open sea. We're global people, right from our very genetic makeup. I have ancestral genes from people from Africa, China, America. I'm a global citizen here, and all of us are. Whereas once you become like inward looking and boxed into some little paranoid place in your mind and in your physicality, then I think that civilization is coming to an end. And I lament that, to me, it seems that the Brexit lot are doing that. Well, it's completely opposed, and it's not surprising. It's organised by what I call right-wing esotericists. Steve Bannon, the archdoyen of that, but also Nigel Farage and other cronies. And Dominic Cummings now has joined that team. You know, these are myopic people with only their own, you know, their own perception as the mark. There's no objective morality. They haven't thought through the consequence of what they're doing. You know, these people are poorly educated, is to put it in summary form. And they're operating from different forms of ignorance. Okay, let's look at it. Let's analyse it. One form of ignorance is what we can call racism, which is a form of ignorance that is hatred of the other. Hatred of the other because of the way they look or talk or sound, instead of love of the other. You know, oh, here's something interesting. Here's a person who's got slightly different colour skin to me, or has slightly different hairstyle, or has a different language, or can sing different types of songs. I mean, I've just met somebody down in the Pyrenees who was part Moroccan, had an incredible singing voice. It was a pleasure to spend time and share songs. You know, I'm doing kind of Druid-type ballads. She sang a song from the Song of Songs in Hebrew and one in Arabic. There is no God but God. You know, this is a master person, singer. And what an amazing encounter. Now, the opposite of love is racism and hatred. Well, no, that's... Sorry, but we can't afford as a planet to do that racism thing anymore. That was what World War II was all about. We fought that off. We won. My parents' generation won World War II on the side of the left esoteric tradition. And London was not destroyed. London survived. And Brexit, it seems to me, is the last attempt by the hard right esotericists to kind of win that war all over again in the name of racism, nationalism and populism. But it comes out of ignorance, because it's usually fear of the other is based on ignorance of the other. You know, if you don't actually know any Moroccans, you might think, well, they're all crazy, they're Arabs, they're terrorists. Then there's ignorance based on greed, which is Buddha pointed out, Gautama Buddha, that greed is the cause of most forms of suffering, and avidya, ignorance. Now, in our case, Brexit is caused by the greed of very wealthy people who have millions stashed in offshore bank accounts in outside the reach of the EU at the moment, who are afraid of the increasing move towards taxation of overseas holdings by people resident in Europe. And businesses based in Europe can't keep their profits off in banks' accounts elsewhere. So there's an attempt to get an overall general system for taxation. But these very wealthy people, who a lot of them operate out of the city of London and Britain, are afraid. They have an ignorance based on the greed of their money, based on the fear of the loss of that if the UK stays in the EU and their tax havens are rumbled. Well, you know, so it's a fear, it's an ignorance based on greed and fear. Well, that's no reason to destroy the happy harmony of a whole continent of people. It's you know, some of the worst forms of ignorance are kind of hysterical fear-based things. When I was a little child, I was afraid of the dark. I would see phantoms and pictures, and I had a very vivid imagination, my parents used to say. Well, I did. I'm a poet, philosopher, and nobody taught me about the nature of the mind. It was a while later that I discovered meditation and Buddhism and how to control, as it were, these nightmares that we have at night, and to work with lucid dreaming and to realise that we can actually control our visions. We can, you know, we don't have to be tormented by them or afraid of them. And that's a psychological skill the Dalai Lama has just said, that kids ought to be taught how to meditate, how to ultimately be happy. He's just launched a very important project, which colleagues and friends are involved with, experts on education and philosophy, to reform the world's education system so that it becomes less concerned and obsessed with money, status, digitization, numeracy, you know, power,